So I guess we should get right back into this, right?
I'm ready.
Okay. So welcome to part two of the Alaska World War II Battlecruiser talk. Again, I'm Jack Russell from the Naval Institute Press, and I have Ryan Szimanski from Battleship New Jersey here with me. This is sponsored by the Naval Institute. You can use code Portholes for 25% off your purchase on the website. And the Portholes podcast is brought to you by Bering Strait Network. So, Ryan, we were just discussing Alaska and what a World War II battlecruiser would look like or could be. Let's talk about some of the other ships that nations had. We've already touched on B-64 and 65 mm-hmm. A little bit. But let's talk about some of the other ships that were sort of on paper, some of which were actually started, that kind of fall in this large cruiser, battle cruiser realm, and see if maybe those ships could help us decide, you know, what Alaska is. Mm-hmm. Now, I definitely mm-hmm. agree with you in the point that we made last time. Alaska is a large cruiser. Mm-hmm. It is just a physically large cruiser with a larger than average caliber gun. So in this case, 8 inches for a heavy cruiser. This is 12, but we're lacking any type of battleship protection, both in terms of armor, underwater. So it's just a physically large ship, but that doesn't mean it's not a cruiser. And then we have World War I era battle cruisers and designs that are now carried forward into World War II, Hood and sort of the R class, right? All of those battle, or am I confusing that?
I would say that Hood is a fast battleship, not a battle cruiser, as completed. The okay. design certainly started as a battle cruiser, but Renown and Repulse, mm-hmm. Refit and Repair, they are.
they're definitely.
Yeah, they are the last completed British battle cruisers in my book.
They're like Queen Elizabeth Light.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. So we've already discussed that where, you know, you drop some armor, you drop a turret, and then you end up with...
You stretch them a little bit longer and throw some engines in there and...
Okay. Okay. So that's where we are for World War II. Then you have Alaska.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have Scharnhorst and Gneisenau.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's... Those ships are perfect examples, you know, built, completed, fought, sunk. So let's touch on those really quickly. I want to hear your take on this since you brought it up last episode. What do you think about Scharnhorst?
So first of all, Scharnhorst and Gneisenau are laid down as Panzerschiff D and E.
They're the evolution of what Graf Spee, like the Deutschlands, mm-hmm. are. So it's the idea that we've stretched it a little bit. We've added a little bit more protection. Here's a third turret. So they're very much along those same lines.
Yeah, and then the original design only has two turrets. And then as Hitler works with Neville Chamberlain to create the Anglo-German naval agreements, mm-hmm. the design is allowed to blow up and blow up and blow up till it matches Washington Treaty battleship definitions. Mm-hmm. However, Germany doesn't have a... full-size battleship caliber gun ready to go yet, and they don't really want to push things mm-hmm. By jumping right into a battleship caliber gun and making all of their neighbors wary of them. So they stick with the same 11-inch gun. It's a couple calibers longer than the one on the pocket battleships, but they stick with the same 11-inch main battery, which is downright anemic for a 35,000-ton battleship. And yet, their armor protection goes up through the roof. In fact, their armored belts are a little bit thicker than Bismarck's belt. The total protection, not as great, but just like if you look at the thickness of the belts on these two ships, mm-hmm. like this has battleship-level armor, and it has fast battleship-level speed or mm-hmm. cruiser-level speed or battlecruiser-level speed in excess of 30 knots, but the firepower is really lacking. And we've got a term for heavy armor, heavy guns. Mm-hmm. We've got a term for heavy speed, heavy guns. We don't really have a term for what they are.
Which is heavy armor.
Heavy speed.
Sub-caliber weapon for what a battleship should be.
And even if you argue that, mm-hmm. They were always designed to be re-gunned with the 15-inch gun.
Which I would.
Then they still have one turret less than they're supposed to and less firepower. And in the last one, we talked about how anything less than 8 barrels, you're not dropping enough shells on the target to really get accurate gunnery.
So, with that being said, Scharnhorst battleship, battlecruiser, super, or heavily armored supercruiser? What?
They do follow the Imperial Navy's battleship designation in having 3 propellers instead of 4 like the battlecruisers would have.
But hold on just a second.
Mm-hmm.
By World War II,
mm-hmm.
pretty much most German capital ships have 3 propellers.
Right, exactly. So is this just an expansion of their original pocket battleship design, which granted only had 2 propellers, mm-hmm. or is it like we're falling back to this design principle, which you can say the Kriegsmarine and even the Wehrmacht, not the Weimar Republic's Navy, the Reichsmarine,
something like that.
Mm-hmm. You can say that those are completely different from the Imperial Navy, mm-hmm. but remember it's the same people, the folks who are designing
these
ships.
It hasn't been that long. It's the same, yeah, it's the same group. It's the same thinking. We've just, you know, polished a few things here and there, you know, depending on the person in charge. Absolutely. I have always thought of the Scharnhorst class as battleships.
Mm-hmm.
And I base that on because of the armor protection.
Mm-hmm.
That's just at least where it is. Now, it makes sense that what we've discussed before, because they're not trying to push their luck, they don't have a battleship caliber weapon ready to go. They stick with the 11-11, so you end up with 3x mm-hmm. 3-11. And that actually kind of works out for them because of the mission that they go on. In the same way that it works out for, you know, maybe, okay, well, it doesn't work out for Greifswald, but but the idea is that if you're shooting at lighter targets, like heavy cruisers, light cruisers,
mm-hmm.
merchant ships,
mm-hmm.
you don't need a battleship caliber weapon. Actually, I would prefer the smaller caliber weapon.
For commerce rating, absolutely. Mm-hmm. That is a better weapon.
So it's almost like a battleship which has a very goofy main battery that's designed for the job that they actually then go out and perform, you know, shooting at carriers and other things. Of course, then as the war goes along, you say, well, okay, we desperately, these need bigger guns. But then, as mentioned, well, now we're going to have 6 barrels of 15-inch, and is that really worth it? So I'll circle back to the refit when we talk about another almost battle cruiser. That brings us to the class of German ship which wasn't built following Bismarck and Tirpitz, and that's the O class.
Mm-hmm.
Those are very interesting because I've seen them called battle cruisers.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you take Scharnhorst and Gneisenau just off the table,
yeah.
and you look at Bismarck and Tirpitz, the O class is the battle cruiser of Bismarck. It's missing some armor. It's missing a turret. It's got a lot of the same secondary guns. It's got a lot of the same sort of features. It's just you're trading the armor and the turret for speed.
I would agree with that. In a lot of ways, the designs of Plan Z were regressive, not progressive. And that is very much the traditional World War I era battlecruiser design.
Like just in concept, it fits the battlecruiser description. And mm-hmm. had it been built, you could say that would be a World War II.
Yes, mm-hmm. exactly. I've been... Through episode 1, I was saying that no battle cruiser, no true battle cruiser was completed in the World War II time period, the 30s and 40s. But that does not mean that they weren't designed. And the O class is a perfect example of a traditional battle cruiser design. Likewise, one of the preliminary designs for the Iowa class featured a 35-knot ship armored against 8-inch gunfire with 12 guns in the main battery designed to hunt Japanese cruisers. That is also a true battlecruiser design mm-hmm. compared to the fast battleship that actually gets selected and constructed. So there are a few examples of these that are on the design board, at least.
Right. What's interesting about, so obviously the O class gets canceled mm-hmm. with essentially the cancellation. I mean, at the time it wasn't a cancellation, but it was of the Z plan.
Mm-hmm.
So that goes away. Krupp obviously has a hard enough time producing the requisite number of guns and turrets for Bismarck and Tirpitz. Obviously, you know, we have to now build six more for the refit of Scharnhorst and Gneisenau, mm-hmm. another six for 2O class. It goes beyond their production capabilities. And obviously the main focus is to get Bismarck and Tirpitz out as quickly as possible. We'll keep Scharnhorst and Gneisenau the way they are.
Mm-hmm.
If we can manage, we'll, you know, refit them in the future.
Yeah, they have so few capital ships mm-hmm. that they can't take one off the table for major work.
And as we said, the Scharnhorst and Gneisenau working together in commerce rating, their 11-inch guns are almost perfect.
Mm-hmm.
So why bother? So that's the Germans. I don't recall any Royal Navy supercruisers because they have retained a lot of traditional battle cruisers,
mm-hmm.
As we've already discussed. Is there, I haven't really seen any designs for like a large cruiser from the Royal Navy.
Yeah, the Royal Navy battle line does still have a fast wing with the refit, repair, and UD. And then they start working on Vanguard to be a fast variant of the Lion class to match this squadron. So they don't really design any traditional battle cruiser designs. They do have some like really rough designs that Churchill wanted to push through, but it doesn't seem like anybody mm-hmm. at the Admiralty actually wanted. Some of them bring back a 9.2-inch gun caliber. And I'm not as familiar with these designs, but some of them might go up to a 12-inch gun.
There are designs of a large sort of heavy cruiser
mm-hmm.
with a larger than 8-inch gun. Mm-hmm. That's also...
Which I would argue mm-hmm. pushes them into cruiser killer territory and out of traditional sure. heavy cruiser.
Sure. I guess what I'm getting at is something... Those ships, though, could still ride the line between heavy cruiser and sort of large cruiser, you know, whereas where I'm thinking at this point, like the size above...
Yeah, they're definitely bigger than heavy cruisers, but they don't go quite as far as the Alaskas, where you do start to touch on the light end of battleship displacement and firepower and everything else.
Mm-hmm. How about the Dutch?
Ooh, okay, yeah, okay.
So the Dutch say, okay, we see all this Japanese aggression. We can't possibly hope to, you know, build this huge fleet to send it there to protect all of our interests in the Pacific. So we'll build one or two cruiser killer, large cruisers
mm-hmm.
To place in various strategic points. The idea is that those ships are not going to necessarily stop the Japanese. Mm-hmm. It just means that in order for the Japanese to counter the Dutch ships, they would have to devote battleships,
mm-hmm.
which, of course, for any navy is a big thing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so especially for the Japanese, it's like, okay, well, you know, we only have a certain amount of battleships. So if I have to send Nagato or mm-hmm. Mutsu, you know, to go deal with one Dutch supercruiser, well, that's a significant portion. Obviously, they're not going to send Yamato to go deal with some supercruiser.
And this goes against Mahanian naval theory, mm-hmm. where you concentrate your battle force.
Mm-hmm. So the Dutch supercruiser
mm-hmm.
is very much a large cruiser. It's not a battle cruiser. It's not a battleship. It very much is a large cruiser that they were just going to buy the main battery from Scharnhorst. Mm-hmm. It was a copy paste, like 3x3 exact thing. We're going to buy it from the Germans. This was as the war was kind of kicking off right before then. They liked what they saw in the Scharnhorst. And then, of course, you know, Hitler goes to conquer Europe. And of course, that all falls through.
Yeah. Yeah. It is very much what everybody outside of Germany thought Scharnhorst was. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely wild that you would build a ship with heavier armor than your main battery gun. You design a ship around a main battery, and then you armor it against its own gun. You don't know what the performance of an enemy country's guns are, mm-hmm. but you do know what your own is, and you assume that you're not going to build a ship with smaller guns than what everyone else is using. Mm-hmm. So if you armor your ship against your own size gun, then that is perfect for the role of that ship. So everybody looks at Scharnhorst and assumes a ship with 11-inch guns, it's going to be armored against 11-inch guns. And
not 14 or 15 or 16,
yeah, there's no way that it's going to have like a 13.5-inch armored belt. That would be absurd. Why would you waste that much metal, those resources, mm-hmm. on this ship, especially when you want a lighter, more disposable ship to be a commerce raider? There's no way that some sort of megalomaniac would push their ego into the project and cause gigantism.
Well, real quick before we get back to the Dutch ship, but mm-hmm. you see Scharnhorst and Gneisenau now. Scharnhorst puts up one heck of a fight against Duke of York.
She takes a heavy beating.
I mean, obviously she takes torpedoes and other shell calibers, but it's to your point, that's she puts up a pretty good defense against a larger an actual battle. Now, granted, Churchill was never very happy with the KGVs. Mm-hmm. He would have rather have had like Lion, mm-hmm. you know, with 16-inch guns. KGV is this awful stopgap that they lay down, and then if they had waited a little bit longer, then like the United States, you end up with a 16-inch gun North Carolina instead of a 14-inch gun North Carolina, which would have been awful.
Yeah, a lot of compromises in that class.
So, but still, though. 14-inch versus 11-inch, but you see the armor really hang in there. And then, of course, with Gneisenau, I mean, it suffers a magazine detonation from a bomb. And, well, we've seen what magazine detonations do to capital ships, Arizona. Mm-hmm. So the fact that, yes, that bomb hit does a lot of damage and forces them to decide to do that 15-inch refit, but it doesn't blow the bow of the ship off, send turret one like into the next county, you know, and then just the whole thing's a write-off. So it's definitely there's the evidence is there to say that, yes, they actually were overbuilt for the gun caliber.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that may well be the only time that a battleship sized vessel suffers a magazine explosion and is not just immediately written off.
Right.
Like so that's pretty remarkable. And I would argue that it's not so much that Scharnhorst or Bismarck, for that matter, put up a really strong fight. They don't really do much damage to their overwhelming attackers, mm-hmm. but they do take a tremendous beating before succumbing that mm-hmm. is probably in excess of what most other nations' capital ships could do.
Mm-hmm. We're not going to get into the Bismarck today. That'll be a future episode. Ryan and I have very strong and somewhat differing opinions on that particular capital ship. So anyway, we'll save that. Did you have anything more to add about the Dutch ship? I can keep going.
Well, before we get to that, now that we've talked about what people thought Scharnhorst was, mm-hmm. or that class was, that is very much the type of ship that the Alaskas are designed to counter.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to countering heavy cruisers, they can also counter this
new breed of super cruiser.
Exactly. And it's also what the French look at and see mm-hmm. and design a ship to counter in the Dunkirk class. So they're building ships that are smaller than battleships, mm-hmm. they've got a smaller main battery gun, 11, 12, 13 inches, and they're armored against their own caliber gun.
Mm-hmm.
So you just have the Scharnhorst, which we think is armored against 11-inch guns, but in reality is armored against 15-inch guns.
I know. So what about Dunkirk and Strasbourg, mm-hmm. right? Obviously, they have very their careers aren't that great. They spend most of the time up and down off the seabed. yes, they are built to counter Scharnhorst and Gneisenau, but they're like footnotes in World War II naval history.
Yeah, well, the French Navy participation in World War II entirely. France has a rough run of it, and they were not able to use the ships the way they were intended to be used. Mm-hmm. And I should put out there that not only were the Dunkirks designed to counter the pocket battleships and mm-hmm. the Scharnhorsts, they could also counter the older Italian battleships that had been rearmed with 13-point whatever inch guns
or something.
Yeah, like 13.4 or something.
Something strange.
And had equivalent armor and whatnot. So they had multiple uses in the Mediterranean and the North Atlantic against opponents that were likely out there, but they were still smaller than a true battleship.
You look at Dunkirk and then you just compare it to Richelieu.
Yeah.
The battleship is the same design, essentially just sized up mm-hmm. a little bit in terms of gun caliber and protection
and significantly heavier displacement.
Sure. Right. That's interesting that you brought up the Mediterranean. We like to think of these open water, U.S. Navy Pacific engagements mm-hmm. or even open Atlantic, mm-hmm. big caliber guns firing at longer ranges. And then you have the Mediterranean. And it's interesting that the Italians, so you have the older battleships that have been completely rebuilt.
Mm-hmm.
Like World War II, Giulio Cesare is like
a completely different ship.
Yeah. It's not even, and I think it's the same, like you said, it's the same 13-inch gun, but they bore out the liner.
Yeah, they take a 12-inch gun and bore it out to make it 13 and some change.
Whatever it comes out to be. So I understand that for for the French, who have colonies in North Africa, you can put a ship like Dunkirk there and sortie out against maybe some of the older ships. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting that the Italians then would build like a Littorio, like the Littorio class, with no real ambition of going outside the Mediterranean. Or am I wrong in saying that?
No ambition to leave the Mediterranean for sure, but they wanted to be able to dominate the Mediterranean.
So by having a like contemporary World War II, 15, 3x3, 15-inch battleship that would just, there's the French, obviously have, 2x4
mm-hmm.
or four, what is it? Four times two.
Two quad turrets.
There you go. Two quad, very poorly placed turrets.
Debatable, but.
Whatever, just get that out of here. Yeah. Okay. Of course, we could talk about Italian shell manufacturing all day long and, how well that worked and fuel shortages and everything else. I don't think the Italians had any sort of real large cruiser project. I mean, they had very few heavy cruiser mm-hmm. units.
Mm-hmm.
I think a few of the Italian ship design companies had a larger, kind of like we were discussing with the Royal Navy, like a larger heavy cruiser on the books, but it doesn't quite meet the Alaska size.
Yeah, no. And Saldo built or designed a Deutschland analog, a pocket battleship mm-hmm. analog, which I would put in the cruiser killer category. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it is orders of magnitude below the Alaska's capability.
So we've talked about Japanese Mm-hmm. So I think the Japanese actually come pretty close. I mean, obviously they're not built. They're not even started. I mean, mm-hmm. they're ordered, but they're not even. Mm-hmm. But as far as the design concern, I think they do a pretty good job at building a large cruiser, just an enlarged cruiser, 3x3, 12-inch. Obviously, we have the Scharnhorst and whatever they are. Mm-hmm. Brits not so much. Italians not so much. French. The French get into this weird thing where they like the way Richelieu and Jean Bar are going. Mm-hmm. So we're like, okay, well, we'll stick a third turret in the back. But then we're like, well, we like kind of like the gun caliber of Dunkirk and Strasbourg. So we'll design a few sort of iterations of that. But of course, that never goes anywhere. So I would count them out. That leaves us with, at least in my mind, the Soviet Union.
Okay.
They actually, this is very interesting. So we know, you've heard of Kronstadt, right? The large battle cruiser, super cruiser mm-hmm. that was laid down sort of in the late 30s. And this is an interesting. So, of course, Stalin wants battleships. Mm-hmm. He's crazy about it, just like every other dictator.
Yeah, it's interesting when the megalomania gets involved, you get these super battleships.
So we obviously want battleships. Russian industry is like, we can't build battleships. But, you know, if you don't, you go to Gulag. Yeah. So we've gotten far enough by the late 30s where we can lay down Sovietsky Soyuz. Mm-hmm. Kronstadt is a battle cruiser thing that they really shouldn't have. It should have been a design study that then let them that they could have just put away for a while and then come back to later. But they're so eager to get something in the water that they start Kronstadt. It's supposed to be these battle cruiser. I'm going to use the word battle cruiser because the planned armor is definitely better than large cruiser. Mm-hmm. It's definitely it's sub battleship, but it's definitely the protection is there to call it a battle cruiser. Stalin wants battleship caliber guns, mm-hmm. but the Russian sort of home-built 16-inch prod-like gun is not ready yet, and there's already so many Sovietsky Soyuz battleships on the books that it's like we can't even build enough guns to supply one hull yet. Yeah. You know, you want 15 of these things or however many is the actual number ordered. So then they turn to Germany, mm-hmm. which we're friends with, by mm-hmm. the way, you know, before
briefly
before Barbarossa. And they're like, we want to buy the 15-inch twin turret from Bismarck. We've already talked about this particular turret.
Yep.
The only reason why I bring this up is, because a couple months ago, I did an article about this on in the World of Warships page. So the Germans agree to sell the 15-inch twin turret from Bismarck mm-hmm. to the Russians. Mm-hmm. And they're like, and then they got a bunch of other stuff too, including the last unfinished Admiral Hipper.
Yeah. Yeah. Nearly finished heavy cruiser.
No guns. No, it's like, so figure it out here. take your unfinished hull and go away. For raw material and food supplies and I don't know, the kind of stuff that's going to be needed to invade another large country.
Hmm. Who could that be?
I don't know. So the Russians are like, okay. And again, Krupp can barely finish Bismarck and Tirpitz, and they need turrets for Scharnhorst and Gneisenau potentially. Mm-hmm. And now I got to give 6 to the Russians. Okay. That's not going to happen. So ultimately, no turrets were ever delivered. Shocker. Okay. But the idea was Kronstadt and Sevastopol, the sisters, mm-hmm. would get 6 15-inch guns. They would have the armor and the speed to sort of match, you know. So they, in my mind, are definite battle cruisers. Now, maybe in the context of a greater war, but with nothing else Russian to really compare them to, because they would be better than October Revolution, you know, like those like ancient dreadnoughts that the Soviets were attempting to still use, with like 13 inch guns, I think, or 12, some of them 12.
Yeah. 12 inch guns in triple turrets.
So those would definitely have been, in my mind, battle cruisers. And then especially, once Sovetsky Soyuz, those hulls started to be completed. So it's interesting, but then once Barbarossa happens and then we realize, well, we're not getting German 15 inch turrets anymore. The Soviets do then say, okay, well, we're going to complete these hulls with a new 12 inch gun that we've just sort of developed.
Mm-hmm.
So then the ships will be launched as, you know, 3x3, 12 inch. So again, we're similar to Alaska. We're still better armored though. Mm-hmm. So again, getting back to like Scharnhorst, the ships are never completed, though. I mean, obviously, the war takes its toll.
Yeah.
What's interesting is a German surveillance aircraft flies over the incomplete hull of Kronstadt, and it looks down, and it sees a ship, a large ship,
mm-hmm.
that's basically hollow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's some subdivisions and such, and it's like, and they go and they report back to their bosses, and German intelligence thinks the Soviets are building an aircraft carrier. Simply because there's no structures internally that would make this look like it's a gun ship.
No barbettes, which are one of the earliest things that you're building.
There was no barbettes, and the Soviets wouldn't build a barbette until they figured out what gun. Mm-hmm. Because obviously, you know, if it's a 15-inch, we need this, or if it's 12, it needs... so.
Which is not very economical, because your armor and your guns are mm-hmm. the longest lead items. They mm-hmm. take the longest to make. So you start by ordering those, and then you build the hull, and then you install. So these ships are all...
Kronstadt was just a disaster. It's just, it was a waste of time, and ultimately a waste of material. And you could say that about all the other big gun Soviet ships, like Sovetsky Soyuz, which, again, at the end of the war, everything that had been started had been scrapped. I mean, if the yard had been captured by the Germans, it had been, the hulls had been, like, parts of them had been ripped off for scrap, then sabotaged mm-hmm. so that in case of recapture, it would be very difficult. So whatever was left by the end of the war was just scrapped. So, of course, Sovetsky Soyuz and all of, and some of a few other hulls that had been started or parts had been assembled, scrapped. Kronstadt, which was the furthest along out of any of them, scrapped. Sevastopol, which was like a couple keel pieces and a pile of metal reclaimed.
I should say, in theory, it makes sense. You're rebuilding your industry from scratch. It's not like the United States, Germany, Great Britain, Japan, where they had this industry and then it sort of dies down in the interwar period and then you're jumping back into it with both feet. When you're completely rebuilding your industry from scratch, it does make sense to start with a smaller design and to work out all the kinks and take longer than the average of 3 or 4 years that it would take to build a ship like this. Take 6 or 7 and sort it all out and then go from there to this larger design. So in that respect, these ships make sense. In the respect that they're building them at the exact same time that they're building the Soviet Soyuz, you're starting after not building battleships for a full generation, mm-hmm. 2 decades, that you then are just like, all right, let's build the biggest thing in the world. And let's build 15 of them and a couple of other ships of various sizes.
Mm-hmm.
That, again, megalomania.
You're right. Right. So, exactly. But then... Continuing.
It gets better.
So Stalin, of course,
mm-hmm.
we're now victorious.
Mm-hmm.
I still need large gun capital ships. Okay.
Or else people will think I have a small penis.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
So he goes, okay, we don't really need battleships.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty apparent.
Mm-hmm.
But we did develop this 12-inch gun. Okay, we're going to scrap Kronstadt because that's very much a 1930s mm-hmm. ship.
Yeah.
Like to have finished that post-war would have been dumb. You would have had one ship that would have been a maintenance nightmare because of who knows how many things. And it would have been, you know, one ship, Hood shared a lot of...
Yeah, commonality with the R-class and the refit and repair and the Queen Elizabeths.
But like a one class, like a one-off ship that really is just completely separate from the rest of the fleet is just a logistics nightmare.
Yep.
All right, I got to carry this fitting specifically for this. I got to carry this specific ammo for, you know, it's just, so they go, okay, get rid of that. What I want is a new class of super cruiser. And this is going to be interesting because this project, which ultimately becomes Stalingrad's, they have these really good 12-inch guns,
mm-hmm.
very much like Alaska,
mm-hmm.
but Stalingrad has the armor protection to sort of that goes well beyond Alaska, and so, you know, I'm going to still use the word large cruiser
mm-hmm.
because that's what it is.
Yeah,
the Russians have their own limitations, especially like in the Black Sea area, to where countries like Turkey are like, guess what? You can't bring battleships through our waters or aircraft carriers. And that still holds up, which is why the Russians build, you know, the cruiser carrier, you know, all those goofy things that you see, you know, with the angled decks. And
yeah, the key class.
Yeah, exactly. So the Russians very much want to avoid building battleships for this very reason. So we're going to build the best large cruiser that we can.
And that makes sense to a certain extent. The Allies have a very small number of battleships that they retain post-war, and most of those go into reserves by the 1950s. Mm-hmm. So your odds of encountering a battleship are not likely. If you do, hopefully you've got a Soviet submarine around to take care of it.
Mm-hmm.
But your odds of running into an Allied cruiser are very high. The Allies have a tremendous number of these wartime cruisers.
Mm-hmm. What? Have you seen the movie Death of Stalin?
I've not.
Okay. You have to. One, it's satirical. Like, mm-hmm. you know, it covers the time, you know, of like the power vacuum after Stalin's death, as they're all like scrambling to like make it look like they're still loyal to him, but like they all want to be in charge.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the best things is whoever wrote this movie is really did their homework, because they talk about the Soviet Navy. The Soviet Navy is like kind of like a joke,
yeah.
you know, at this point. Stalin is very much like, I want these large cruisers. The Navy's like, I ain't got time for that. You know, no one wants these things, which is why as soon as he dies, Stalingrad is immediately halted. The whole plan is canceled, scrapped. They drag this brand new hull, again, for the same reason they scrapped Kronstadt, because mm-hmm. it's like, now we have this one ship. Like, you know, they drag this brand new hull out into the middle of the water and start shooting missiles at it to test various things. And that's it. Then it kind of sinks and that's it.
Yep.
But in that movie, you know, they're like, the Navy comes up a few places and they're like, hey, because they start making fun of the Navy at one point, and it's like, hey, you can't do that, like, in front of Stalin, because he was super, like, he was like, this is something that I need, you know, and he, while everyone else was like, who cares, you know, of course, the Red Army is all, like, you know, big and bad, because they had just defeated Nazi Germany. Okay. yeah, okay. And then, like, at the funeral, the Navy has like shows up with this like absolutely monstrous wreath. Like it's the biggest one there, you know, like, thank you, Stalin, for championing us for so long for no reason. but yeah, so it's just, again, like you said, megalomaniac. Yeah. I have to have a large big gun warship.
And I've made fun of him for that, but to be a great power, you have to be able to project power,
mm-hmm.
project power overseas. And the only way to do that is with a Navy. Now, should that Navy include monstrously oversized capital ships? Probably not all the time, but
they do look pretty.
You do need capital ships to go overseas and show the flag and act as deterrents. And that is not what I criticize Stalin for. It is for the scale of these things, mm-hmm. how many resources he was going to put into it, and yet develop something that was no more potent than the other ships that were already out there, significantly cheaper and lighter and older and mm-hmm. whatnot. And that's where the folly really is.
Right. Before we end this particular mm-hmm. episode and ultimately our Alaska discussion in both parts one and two. So Alaska is the lead ship in six that are ordered.
Mm-hmm.
And they're obviously not heavy cruisers, mm-hmm. which are named for sort of cities.
Yep.
And then battleships are named for states.
Yep.
So Alaska and company are named for territories, which mm-hmm. of course Alaska and Hawaii are not states yet. So you have, and there's like Guam and Puerto Rico.
And the Philippines and Samoa to round it out. So yeah, mm-hmm. some of them still territories today.
So they get authorized in 1940, I believe, mm-hmm. or right around the...
They're authorized as part of the Two Ocean Navy Act.
Right.
I think that's 1940.
Exactly. And that's when you get a lot of these other bigger ships as well. You get a lot, you know, you get more carriers, you get the Iowas, mm-hmm. right? Montana is even in there.
Yep. They're authorized at the same time.
Do you get all six? I think the two Illinois and Kentucky are added later, correct? To
right.
that build sheet? Okay.
Yeah. And almost in place of getting the Montanas anytime soon. It's like, well, we still want more, but we haven't really refined that design yet. Let's just build two more of this.
Okay. So all these ships are ordered at the same time. December 7, 1941,
mm-hmm.
battleship era, done. Carriers, obviously, emerge as the dominant force. Yes, no, maybe so.
I wouldn't say that the attack on Pearl Harbor is... like the complete turning point,
mm-hmm.
but it sure is.
It gets you there.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
Sometime soon.
A couple of days later, when uh-huh. Japanese aircraft are able to sink a modern British battleship underway, Prince of Wales,
mm-hmm.
which is the first time in world history that aircraft sink a battleship that's underway, that certainly turns some heads. And then when the carriers are able to duke it out in Coral Sea and Midway without seeing each other,
mm-hmm.
now we finally made it there. The technology exists for these aircraft to carry large enough bombs over a long enough range to keep their carriers safe and destroy capital ships.
Okay. So we talked about, when we talked about Kronstadt, we mm-hmm. talked about the fact that the Russians hadn't installed barbettes.
Mm-hmm.
So you're building Alaska and Guam mm-hmm. are being built. Okay. Pearl Harbor happens.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then Midway happens. Okay. Well, now we need more carriers.
Mm-hmm.
So they look at converting the Alaska class into carriers.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, if they were less far along, that might be a thing. But because they're large gun capital like size ships,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The amount of work required to then rebuild them as carriers at that point, it's we'll just wait for the SS class carriers that are also being built at the same time.
Yeah, it's a very similar amount of resources, similar displacement and size, mm-hmm. same engineering plant mm-hmm. between Alaska and Essex. And the Essex, because they're purpose built to do that, is mm-hmm. just a massively superior design.
Mm-hmm.
So why waste the resources mm-hmm. when you've got this huge class to then have this two ship subclass that don't match everything else?
Exactly.
And are significantly less capable.
So they decide to just push forward and complete Alaska. And then, of course, comes Guam
mm-hmm.
and Hawaii. The
she
third,
gets close. She
third ship's like
effort.
80% done. So Alaska and Guam get out there. At that point, there's no real Japanese Navy to shoot at. I think they shoot at some shore targets a couple times, mm-hmm. right?
They're good heavy anti-aircraft batteries.
They're, of course, just like any fast battleship of the time will just cover them in 40-millimeter and 20-millimeter barrels. And
when Franklin is disabled, it's Alaska and Guam that are chosen to go and protect her.
Mm-hmm. So they they kind of have this sub role out there, and then that's it. The war ends. They're immediately mothballed. They sit in storage for like a decade, right? Yeah. Until then, and then, you know, there's talks about converting them with missiles. Like, okay, we can take out turret three and add like a vertical launch system or something, or some sort of launcher, you know, rebuild half the back half of the ship, all kinds of goofy stuff. And then ultimately, you know, that's too expensive. They get scrapped. Wow. Remarkable.
Yeah. Just over a year of service life, maybe 2 years max, a decade in service or in storage, completely brand new, a uniquely designed gun system. It was a waste. We should have either stopped while they were still under construction or kept them around, in my opinion.
So keeping them around, why, and I'm going to pose this question, but we're not going to go into it. We're going to end this here. Why would you keep the Des Moines class of heavy cruisers and not Alaska? If in the post-World War II environment, in the Cold War, mm-hmm. when size becomes this propaganda piece, mm-hmm. and, you know, the bigger the ship, I can, you know, the Iowas get missiles, you know, mm-hmm. so, you know, you have this larger platform. And certainly there's no other nation out there that has a 12-inch gun ship. Why not keep the baby Iowa, you know, in terms of size? Why go heavy cruiser? I mean, the Des Moines have 8-inch guns. I mean, they are auto loading, you know, but, in terms of a propaganda piece, you know, if I was an admiral and I couldn't have an Iowa and it was Alaska or Des Moines, well, you pick the bigger ship.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, and as we discussed, it's not like the 12-inch gun was a slouch. I don't know what you're shooting at, but
yeah,
still, you know.
You've got a for sure bombardment in addition to mm-hmm. having more space for flag spaces.
Mm-hmm.
The whole reason the Iowa class battleships continue to be used as flagships is because you've got no room on an aircraft carrier island mm-hmm. for a big admiral and flagstaff.
Mm-hmm.
So use the battleship. Well, the Alaskas can be used for that, and they're cheaper.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, poor Alaska then. You know, they don't get their time in the sun. You know, in the Cold War, as I think they should, and they could have. What's really interesting, and I think I've made this point to you, but what if you get rid of the Iowas and the Alaska? Because if suddenly after the war we spend all this money, mm-hmm. we've got combined tonnage that exceeds every other nation in the world combined mm-hmm. by like a factor of two or three. And all of a sudden overnight, now we're broke and poor and we don't want to spend any money on anything again, which is typical mm-hmm. after a war.
Absolutely.
Why, obviously, battleships, propaganda pieces, we've covered that. But if that's the case, decommission two Iowas and keep the two Alaskas. Would they not be cheaper? And you don't technically need the 16-inch gun power.
No, the 12-inch guns of the Alaska have not exactly the same range, but comparable range. They can still engage basically the same percentage of cities on the planet mm-hmm. Within 20 miles of the coast, where most cities and most population mm-hmm. Centers are focused. Mm-hmm. So where you're probably going to end up fighting your next war.
Mm-hmm. I know that probably, you know, hits a little close to home. You're like, damn, Jack.
I really like the Alaska design, and I don't think it was an aberration. I think that based on what we knew was under construction, what was going on in the world at that time, it made sense to build this type of cruiser killer,
mm-hmm.
Fully expecting that other people were. And by my definition, France and Germany had, mm-hmm. And all of that was now in this Nazi-occupied European control.
Mm-hmm.
So, and Japanese Type A cruisers, Japanese heavy cruisers, are better than their American counterparts at this point. So designing a ship that can hunt those down or hunt enemy commerce or protect your aircraft carriers or do shore bombardment or even, if the need arises, serve in the battle line with the battleships as a fast wing. You're getting a lot of capabilities there, a lot of dominant capabilities for a lot less than a full-size battleship.
Sounds good to me. I think we can agree on this one last fact before we close out this episode. Large cruiser. I'm going to like have a meltdown if I keep seeing Battlecruiser on the internet. And I know.
Yeah.
And I know I will. Right. I don't care. I just.
These ships are not a cruiser and they're not a battlecruiser. They are something else. The U.S. Navy chooses the term large cruiser. And I prefer the term cruiser killer, but they are something distinct. Mm-hmm. And individual from both cruiser and battlecruiser.
There you go. And that's it. That's all we're going to say that about Alaska. We're moving on. And again, thank you everyone for watching this part two of the Portholes podcast. Episode one, which we cover more of, you can go back and watch if you picked it up here. And again, thank you. You can use code Portholes on the USNI website for 25% off your next book order. And we'll see you on the next one. Thank you.